to read during this time. The first one is Stephen King. It's a totally awesome book. It has a lot of different short stories in it. And there he is. Mr. Spooky. So, this is called Just After Sunset. And then, the other book I'm going to show you is Ghost Hunters. Have you ever seen the show Taps? They have a really cool show. And the books are just like their shows. They talk about their cases. And they have commentary, like how they felt about the case and what they got from it and stuff. So it's really cool if you like ghost hunting. And then the third book is called Steampunk Poe. I love steampunk. It's so cool. It's like the most awesome art. This is another. It's like his stories with. They're all different. So, I'll show you that now a little bit. So, the first one I wanted to go over is this one. Actually, my favorite story of Stephen King is The Shining. Unfortunately, I couldn't find that book. I'm not sure where it is. I think somebody probably borrowed it or something, but. Anyway, I wanted to do this because somebody has suggested a whisper video and to read from a couple books, so that's what I'm going to do. And if you have a favorite story from Stephen King, let me know where it is. Write it down below. And I mean, either it's a book or a movie or whatever. I think I celebrate Halloween all the time, but in October I go crazy. I love it. It's so much fun. So, anyway. Stories in here that are really kind of my favorites. Harvey's dream. You know, he has all these bizarre stories he tells, so this one is no different. So, I'm going to read a little bit of this, and then I'll go on to the next one. Janet turns in the sink, and boom. All at once, her husband of nearly 30 years is sitting at the kitchen table in a white t-shirt and a pair of big dog boxers watching her. More and more often, she has found this weekday coming out of Wall Street in just this place and dressed in just this fashion come Saturday morning, slumped over the shoulder and blank in the eye, a white scruff showing on his cheeks. Manseat's going out in front of his tea. Hair standing up in the back like alfalfa and rascals, grown up and stupid. Janet and her friend Anna have frightened each other lately, like little girls telling ghost stories while they sleep over. by swapping Alzheimer's tools. Who can no longer recognize his wife? Who can no longer remember the names of her children? But she doesn't really believe these silent Saturday morning appearances have anything to do with early onset Alzheimer's. On any given weekday morning, Harvey Stevens is ready and raring to go. By 6:45, a man of 60 who looks 54 in either of his best suits, who could still cut a trade by on margin or sell short with the best of them. I'm just reading just like the first paragraph of these. Just kind of like, you know, distant. Janice has never settled on the right word for the place where Buddy lives. It's too big to be called a house, too small to be called an estate. And the name on the post at the foot of the driveway, Harbor Lights, gags her. It sounds like the name of a restaurant in New London, the kind where the special is always fish. She usually winds up just calling it your place, as in, let's go to your place, play tennis, or let's go to your place and go swimming. It's pretty much the same deal with Buddy himself. She thinks him watching him trudge up the lawn toward the sound of shouts on the other side of the house, where the pool is. You didn't want to call your boyfriend Buddy, but when you're reverting to his name, your name meant Bruce. It left you with no real ground to stand on. This one is commute. There are three confession booths. The light over the door in the middle room was on. No one was waiting. The church was empty. Colored light came through it in the windows and made squares on the central aisle. Mona thought about leaving and didn't. Instead, he walked to the booth that was open for business and went inside. When he closed the door and sat down, the little slider on his right opened. In front of him, tacked to the wall with a blue push button with a file card, typed on it was "For all who have sinned and fallen short of God's glory." It's been a long time, but when I didn't think that was standard equipment, he didn't even think it was Baltimore Catechism. From the other side of the mesh screen, the priest spoke. "How are you doing, my son?" When I didn't think that was standard either, but it was all right. Just the same, he couldn't reply at first, not a word. And that was sort of funny considering what he had to say. "Kick at your tongue." Still nothing. The words were there, but they were all blocked up. Absurd or not, Mona had a sudden image of a clogged toilet. The blur beyond the screen shifted. "Been a while?" "Yes," Mona said. "It was something." "We want me to give you a hint?" "No, I remember. Last week, Father, if I had sinned." So a lot of, maybe his earlier stuff, King wrote about his childhood or places that he used to work, people that he knew. I don't know how much he still is doing that, but he's a pretty good writer. He creeps me out pretty good. This was pretty cool. It was a pretty quick read. I if you guys have any, you know, ghost stories you'd like to tell, or any places you've been that is kind of spooky, let me know. You know, write it down below. I'd love to hear them. So, this book is exactly like the show. Like, they talk about their cases, and then they have the, like, the take on their case, like, you know, Grant is talking about how people kind of see them as investigators. So, he says, people often look at us strangely when we tell them to communicate with the spirits haunting their homes, but sometimes it's the only way to make a house livable again. If you had a neighbor who wasn't doing something bothersome, who was doing something bothersome, rather, you would talk to him, wouldn't you? It's the same with a ghost. So. They get involved like right away if a kid, like if the children are involved, if they're getting scared and they can't sleep in their own house, they try and do their best to help them out. So, Grant again is talking about when you encounter the family and how they can be very confused about who it is that's bothering them. So he says, sometimes people have no idea whose spirit may be haunting them. In this case, the Taylors had an idea of that long before we got there. Our job was only to confirm it and help them figure out what to do about it. Cases. Says it takes some work to find people who live up to what they say they can do. Lots of people are eager to go on a ghost hunting jaunt, and they assure us they're serious. But the tedium of the long hours deep into the night puts them to the test, and not everyone passes. Only a few will stick with us, investigation after investigation, and those are the ones who come to trust them. We come to trust the most. The thing about voluntary groups is that some people interpret voluntary to mean it's not as serious. To us, it's very serious. We're driven by desire to know what the paranormal is all about, and we rely on a team of responsive people who understand the agenda and will do their part to support us. So yeah, these people, they do this voluntarily. I mean, they might get paid for on the side doing whatever they do, but Spring Hills Asylum is one of the places they went to. That's in New York. St. Augustine Lighthouse. That's in Florida, like near Jacksonville. The Stanley Hotel is probably their most famous. It was in The Shining. I really like that. That was really fun to watch that. I think the creepiest part was when they went down into that tunnel and they heard that little girl talking to them. That was really creepy. Creeping them out. So there's a lot of good stories in here if you guys want to check it out. I know it's kind of an older book, but it's really fun to read if you're into ghost hunting or you know someone that's into ghost hunting. And the last one is Steampunk Poe. It's really awesome right here. The pages are kind of thick. I like that. I like the feel of it. This was a really cool picture. So it actually looks like a almost like a haunted house. That was really cool. You can see that. I really like some of these. These little things they put in here. They're talking about a traveler. And the snow is really cool. And all with pearl and ruby glowing was the fair palace door. Through which came flowing, 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 and sparkling evermore. A troop of echoes, whose sweet duty was but to sing, in voices of surpassing beauty, the wit and wisdom of their king. But evil things in robes and sorrow assailed the monarch's high estate. Ah, let us mourn, for never morrow shall dawn upon him desolate. And round about his home, the glory that blushed and bloomed is but a dim remembering story of the old time entombed. And the travelers now within the valley, through the red-litten windows see vast forms that move fantastically to a discordant melody, while like rapid ghastly river through the pale door, a hideous throne rush out forever and laugh but smile no more. I love that song. It's really beautiful. There's another picture. It's really cool. Curses and Murders of Rumor. That picture is really, really pretty. I love how it looks, the bridge and stuff. So yeah, this book's really awesome. Plus I love Poe. Poe is just quintessential for, you know, a lot of people I think really like Poe. So unfortunately, my camera is beeping. I think it's gonna die. But I'd like to read a little bit of The Raven. Raven is probably my favorite, and here is the picture for The Raven. A little cool dude there. So, here's The Raven. Nice part of it. Once upon a midnight dreary, while I pondered weak and weary over many a quaint and curious volume of forgotten lore, while I nodded, nearly napping, suddenly there came a tapping, as of someone gently rapping at my chamber door. "'Tis some visitor," I muttered, "tapping at my chamber door. 'Tis nothing more." Ah, distinctly I remember it was on a bleak December, and each separate dying ember wrought its ghost upon the floor. Eagerly I wished the morrow, vainly I had sought to borrow from my books surplus of sorrow for the lost Lenore, for the rare and radiant maiden whose angel's name Lenore, nameless here forevermore, and the silken, sad, uncertain rustling of each purple curtain thrilled me. Filled me with fantastic terrors never felt before, so that now, to still the beating of my heart, I stood repeating, "'Tis some visitor entreating entrance at my chamber door. Some late visitor entreating entrance at my chamber door. This is it, and nothing more." That's the books I have. I hope you enjoyed it, and I really hope you have a great Halloween, and please be safe. Don't eat too much candy. Alright, thank you for watching. Have a good night.